Today I'm going to talk about issues of conserving fluid commons and how, especially in cities, well, of course in our rural landscapes, but I think especially in our cities, we need to reclaim the identity of water as a commons, as something that's a community resource rather than a privatized resource or a resource that is packaged only for those who can afford it. India is an urbanizing country, as unfortunately or fortunately, depending on your perspective, is the planet at large. We are still a predominantly rural country, but we're already at 31% urban population, and various projections say that by 2045, 2055, certainly soon enough, in the next 20, 30 years, India will cross the cusp and become more than 50% urban. This is a dramatic change and one that several countries around the world had experienced a few decades ago. Several countries around the world are indeed experiencing now, such as China. And we are also a country that is waking up to this challenge and has announced a plan for smart cities, another idea that is capturing a lot of the fancy of the world. These 100 smart cities, or whatever number they come up to at the end, which will come up across India. One of the latest things I saw on the Ministry of Urban Development's website is that smart cities are for smart people, and smart people are defined as those with access to the internet. Now, what does that do really for people who live in cities, vast majority, especially in Indian cities, who don't access the web, are not web-enabled, are not smart, perhaps by this definition? And the growing inequities within these cities, because in India, it seems to be increasingly clear that the locus of poverty is now shifting from the rural to the urban. It's particularly within this context that I want to talk about reclaiming the identity of water as an urban commons, as something for a community to use. And just to add to this, there is place for this in the smart cities documents, because it talks about also having a smart environment, but I don't think we really understand what that means in its fullness, because a smart environment needs to not just be technologically smart or ecologically smart, but also socially smart. And that means socially just, accommodating diverse cultural uses, diverse social uses, diverse economic uses, and non-economic uses. Water is essential for life. But this, unfortunately, is a picture you will see from almost any growing city across India, most parts of the world, really. You have these large apartments coming up where wetlands once were, and you see the degradation of water bodies, the shrinking of water bodies, and eventually many of these disappear or lie in conditions that where they become an eyesore or something that causes a health problem or various other kinds of problems rather than being a resource. So it's the complete opposite of a resource. They're what are called in the ecology language an ecosystem bad rather than an ecosystem good. So in Bangalore, this is something that we've been studying for a while, and this is a long-term program of ecological change that we initiated in 2006, looking at all aspects of urban ecology and environmental change and the social changes associated with that. How do people shape nature in the city? How does nature shape people in the city? That's really what we look at. Water is, of course, a very big part of this. And we've been looking at several lakes and wetlands around Bangalore, looking at how some of these improve over time, and many of them, unfortunately, become worse over time. And you can see two contrasting examples. Incidentally, are from the same lake, which I'll talk about a bit more further on. But these are the really two contrasting phases, of lakes in India. So how do these, as the previous speaker talked about, we've seen, I think, very visibly with the Chennai floods, how closing up of wetlands and rainwater channels and lakes leads to flooding of the city, vulnerability of the city. We saw this definitely in Mumbai a few years ago with the Mithi River and the flooding of Mumbai. This hits the news for a while. We tend to forget it, but after a few months have passed. But no doubt, having access to functioning ecosystems is very important for the resilience of the city. What we are not, I guess, gets left out of the discourse is the fact that they're also important for the resilience of the people within the city. And by the people, I especially mean the ones who are the most disadvantaged, the migrant workers, the people who practice traditional livelihoods, the urban poor, women, children, elderly. So it's those kinds of people who really depend on water the most, and we don't take that part, the resilience of the people within the city and specific kinds of people, as much into our planning discussions. Bangalore, as with Tamil Nadu, as with much of southern peninsular India, where you don't have as many large rivers, it's not like the Gangetic plains where you have these very large rivers that shaped civilization. Nevertheless, has ancient civilizations that developed not around rivers, not around coasts, which is kind of unusual if you think of many ancient civilizations around the world, but developed around local water bodies, what we call tanks, keres in Kannada, in the local language, or lakes. We call them lakes now, but they're mostly created water bodies, created by people who took advantage of local depressions in the land for rainwater harvesting. And these rainwater depressions were used, and that's what villages came up around. You can see that's the boundary of Bangalore, and you can already see that the lakes here are much sparser than they are in the countryside around. But there's a series of lakes, small to large, really small ones used for cattle washing, slightly larger ones, slight pond size used for smaller communities, larger ones used for entire groups of villages together. And that has changed over time. In fact, in the Bangalore area, one of the oldest inscriptions is from a lake called Agra Lake. And in 870 AD, there is an inscription talking about the three lakes there and a particular king who is a vassal of the Ganga dynasty, who fixed sluices to two tanks, had the eastern, which is a third tank, built. We don't know which of these three is, there's one tank left in Agra. We don't know if the other two have been lost or referred to as other lakes. The inscription itself is very hard to trace now. But they also obtained what they called, the king obtained the bituwata of the third tank. And these were irrigation tanks. The aim was that local communities would create them but get tax breaks from the king, because the idea was to expand fertile agriculture, to turn areas that were millet growing areas from dry crops to rice crops. And the bituwata is the rights to harvest the fertile agricultural paddy, now growing land just below the tank. If you look at these inscriptions, you see a very different view of water, a view that has seemingly disappeared from the city today. It's water the sacred, but also water the utilitarian. So a beautiful inscription from this area called Kempapura in 1306 from the Hoysala dynasty says, "We grant with pouring of water as a devadana, as a gift to the king, for this particular god, a village, the tank of the village, all the wetlands and dry lands around the village, that is the irrigated and non-irrigated lands, the wells underground and the trees overground." And you can see this vision of a landscape, this set of associated characteristics is repeated in across many inscriptions. There is a village, there is a temple within the village. The tank is built to provide for agriculture, but also a share of the proceeds is given to the god. The landscape includes the trees above and the wells below, the water below the. So you can see this integrated view that there are wells and there is a groundwater resource which is furnishing the water that is required to grow all these trees. And a lot of these are fertile orchards, and they talk about the fertility of the orchards coming from the lake and coming from the water around them. And if you look at how this landscape grew, it's a fascinating story. So one of the things I've been doing is looking at the archival records, and you have archival records from the 5th century onwards, some of these on copper plates, some of these on hero stones, some of these on stones that are essentially records of land grants. You can use these to trace the first time that a particular village is mentioned. This is not necessarily the fact that the village started at that time, but it seems likely that it's at least somewhere close to the origin of the village, because it's the first time it was mentioned. And you can map this into four dynasties: the Gangas, Cholas, Hoysalas, and then the Vijayanagara Empire, up till 1537, when Kempegowda is believed to have established the modern town of Bangalore. And we tend to believe in this, in the popular discourse that Kempegowda came and constructed this. So he was a local chieftain who constructed this market town of Bangalore, de novo, so to speak, on this land that was completely barren. And if you look at this, these figures, as I'll show you, the land was hardly barren. It was extremely, it's been utilized for a long time. But if you also look at this, this is a topographic map. If you look at the land to the west, it's more hilly, and the land to the east has gentler slopes. And Bangalore is believed to be divided topographically into what is called the Malnad and the Maidan. The Maidan being the flatter slopes, what is also called Bailu in Kannada, the flatter slopes, gentler slopes towards the east. The landscape here is very different, as the inscriptions talk about. This is the kind of landscape that I was giving you, the inscription of from Kempapura, the fertile land with the tanks, the wells, the trees. And you have different kinds of inscriptions from these areas. And there is a more rugged landscape of the Malnad, from which you find few inscriptions. They're largely of hero stones. They describe people dying from wild boar attacks or elephant attacks or leopard kills. They talk about cattle raids. They talk about pastoralist lifestyles. Very different kind of a life. And you see how water, the availability of water, dictates the kind of topography, the ecology, and therefore eventually the livelihoods that people practiced in these areas. So the Malnad area with its rolling hills had very thin soil, less water because it's in the rain shadow area of the Deccan, and essentially dry, scrub, thorny kind of a forest. So that's the place where you can have cattle grazing, but it's very difficult to have agriculture, very difficult to create a tank, right? And therefore you see the Ganga dynasty, most of these new villages, especially the ones with land grants, the ones with records of tanks, are all in the east, in the Maidan, in the flatter plains. A few hundred years later, coming to the Chola dynasty, you have very few new areas, new records of villages. But you still see that they largely stick to the plains areas. And then suddenly there's a spurt in growth during the time of the Hoysala dynasty. And you see a lot more tanks coming across. And you can try and imagine if you go back, for instance, see actually how these are clustering into sub-chains of topography. So as they move into new areas, it's very rare that you see isolated tanks, but you rarely see them in clusters. So people, you know, they build and they were supervised, I'm assuming, by these, you know, whoever the rulers were in that area to build connected chains of tanks. What the Hoysalas called a large body of water was Sandra or Samudra. And therefore, those of you, how many of you are from Bangalore? Several. So all the areas that you think of with the ending name Sandra, Singa Sandra, Malla Sandra, Junna Sandra, which most of them don't have water bodies anymore. All of these mean that there used to be a large water body at that point, at some point in these areas. And then by the time of the Vijayanagar dynasty, now topography slowly starts, you know, people start running out of space essentially. So they have to start moving to the higher ends of the higher regions. Even there, they avoid the completely high elevated areas. So if you can see two large ridges running sort of north-south in the western part of the city, the High Grounds Police Station, for instance, which is why it's called the High Grounds Police Station in Bangalore, that is the highest point in the city. All of those areas are left out. Even within undulating terrain, you tend to have new settlements in valleys where you can have water. And this clearly tells you about the importance that water played for a very long time. What do you get beyond this? Beyond this, we don't have too much of an archival record. What we do have is maps, and the maps start coming in by about 1791 when Tipu Sultan lost Bangalore in the first time to the third Anglo-Mysore War to the British, and then gained it back again after some time. But during that time, we come in with maps. But as I told you, this is what you get in terms of current maps of the city. You have maps from 1791, and I'm confining myself to what was later to become the city and the cantonment areas, because that was what was urban at that point. And you can see there were areas with wells, there were areas of trees. What you can't see here, but if you look at some records of cultivation, you'll see that a lot of these lakes were accompanied by large open wells around them. And that was a link to the landscape. And because of the cultivation, and the cultivation in much of this area was not necessarily rice, but it was orchard crops. You had all kinds of fruit orchards, which were very common in this area. So 1791, this is the kinds of wells that lakes that you have. By 1888, you see a lot of these have disappeared. A few new ones have come. The British did build a few tanks in the city, but a lot of these from before have disappeared. A few new ones, such as the Alsur Lake, got expanded, and you know, so there are a few of those. And then by 2014, they've almost gone. So in the 1880s, Bangalore lost a lot of lakes because there was a misguided feeling at that point that lakes were malarial sources of malaria and needed to be eradicated. There was also a feeling that the city was running out of space, so a lot of lakes were converted into bus stands, malls, shopping areas, a lot of other things. But I want you to focus on one thing. The green dots are the trees. So the number of trees, this was a semi-arid area, didn't have many trees. In 1791, 1888, and now. We talk often about the fact that Bangalore has lost a lot of trees, and indeed it has. It's lost tens of thousands of trees, if not over 100,000 in the past 10, 15, 20 years. But a lot of aggressive planting from, let's say, about the 1850s 50s to about the 1980s, greened the city considerably. It's since then that we've lost a lot of trees. So if we had a map from the 1980s of tree cover, which we don't unfortunately, you would see that the city was a lot greener. So you've had up to a point more people, more trees. But pretty soon it's become a city of more people, less lakes. So there is something to do with our relationship to greenery, which is, seems to be different with our relationship with water. A lot of this can be explained by the fact that sometime in 1888, up till which there was a reasonable amount of water in the city, the lakes in the city, surface water seemed no longer sufficient for the growing population of the city. So the first plan to get water from outside was implemented, the Hesarghatta reservoir. So in about 1890s, they started constructing this reservoir, and a number of new reservoirs started being built at some point. The central part of Bangalore now largely gets its water from outside. And you can clearly see, especially if you look at the archival records which we've been looking at, a shift in the discourse of administration. Suddenly, wells, lakes, smaller water bodies called kalyanis become sources of malaria, sources of cholera, sources of epidemics. They become messy, they become places of filth, you know. And the entire conversation around these water resources changes to the fact that you need to clean them up, you need to fill them up, and you need to convert them into some other kind of resource. You can clearly see when you live next to a resource and you have to use it, you have to keep it clean. But when you get it from outside, there's a huge change. There's also change in the discourse of the administration at this point about the people, the traditional users of these lakes. So there is a preference. For instance, we've been doing some research, a PhD student of mine, Hita Unnikrishnan, and I, looking at Sampangi Tank, which is now the Kantirwa Stadium, the sports stadium of Bangalore. And if you look at the discourses around this, it's very interesting. Around the same time, again, this changes where, so there were traditional communities of fishers, of grazers, of people who wash their clothes. And this lake starts now becoming a different kind of a resource. So there are requests to drain the lake because there's a British regiment who needs to play polo, which is a very different recreational shaping perception of the lake. There's a request to drain the lake again because there are bungalows next to the lake and a brewery next to the lake, and they're getting flooded when the lake gets a lot of water. And at the same time, there are letters written by 100 horticulturalists from a local community of horticulturalists who write to the king saying, because this is land between the Mysore government-owned part of Bangalore and the British government-owned part of Bangalore. So it's sort of somewhere in the middle. And both lay claims to it. The horticulturists don't write to the British administration. They write to their king, whom they pay taxes to, and say, we pay tax to you, and we need this water for our cultivation. And so there's a lot of back and forth then conversation in the records between the king and then the British governor. Eventually, though, the lake gets filled up, polo is played, and the British breweries continue, the bungalows continue to flourish, and eventually the people get, you know, their access gets denied. The Indian government post-independence continues with this, of course, and the lake becomes a stadium, so do many of the other lakes get converted to other kinds of public use. This also brings into mind an interesting question of how we frame our ecosystems, whether they're water systems in this case or any other kinds of systems. An ecosystem is to serve a community, and a community good is the same as a public good. Therefore, it seems like in the policy literature, that you can convert, you can cut down, for instance, a grove of trees, which is a village forest, or you can take a lake and cut it and fill it in. As long as you're doing that for a different kind of public purpose, it's fine. If it's to build a stadium, a bus stop, a school, a village library, it's okay, because it's still a public use. And that's a very different kind of use, because it's a non-ecosystem kind of use. And that concept of the fact that you cannot convert these ones, you know, flourishing ecosystems into different kinds of public uses, does not seem to be there at all. So one of the things we've been doing, apart from looking at the lakes within the city, the ones that I've been talking about, is to look at the lakes in the peri-urban part of the city, which if you do a sort of space for time substitution, in a way this gives you a glimpse of what lakes in Bangalore used to be used or look like maybe 20, 30, 40 years ago, depending on which part of the peri-urban gradient you are. And lakes are a focal node for a variety of commons. You have open wells around them, typically on the east and the west that you had these large wells. And different groups would use these different wells. So there were issues of caste restriction. I mean, this is not a completely harmonious community which never is. So there were the caste exclusions, certain people were allowed to use certain resources, some were excluded from using other resources. But they did have different wells around this. You had gundutops, which are village forests, which had a sacred, some deity within there, but also a lot of used, you know, fruiting trees, which people would use. Cemeteries, again catering to different communities, gaumala or grazing lands, community grazing lands, and single trees that were used for various kinds of ecosystem resources. They provided provisioning services, they gave livelihoods and subsistence use, and they especially were important for the urban and marginalized, as we find even now. This is just an example of the kinds of things we find. Some of these from lakes in the heart of the city, some of this from lakes outside. So you have people washing and watering livestock, the dhobis, household use, migrant workers, for instance. Most of the accommodation that migrant workers have do not come with either bathroom facilities or areas to wash their clothes. Where are they going to go? The lakes. So this is a use we don't think about, but look at the amount of construction going on in a city like Bangalore. And look at where all these migrant workers must be going, to the lakes. And when you start excluding them by fencing off these lakes, this becomes a problem. On the other hand, the lakes become dirty because you have large numbers of, you know, large volumes of people coming and this fluctuating population, which is very hard to build a community spirit around. So these are real challenges. We find that people still use a lot of provisioning raw materials from these lakes. So there's fodder, there's fuel wood, mud, fish, oil, things that you don't think of as coming from lakes. So Madiwala Lake, for instance, which is in the heart of the city, when the lake dries up, people collect certain greens. So there's still agriculture going on from these lakes. And in a dry year, when the lake bed dries up, people collect this green called wanaganesopu from the lake bed. And that's a very important nutritional component of women's diets. And then when you talk to the women, they say, oh, now that the government has fenced this and I don't have access in certain places, I have to buy this and it costs 15 rupees to buy a small set for, you know, for the family. So if you're thinking about protecting these lakes, unfortunately, we tend to exclude all of these uses when we're thinking of conservation because we're thinking of a particular envisioning of the services of these lakes. We don't think of the provisioning services, of the subsistence uses, of the nutritional uses that these provide. We have been now looking at about 75 peri-urban villages across Bangalore, and these are some typical patterns of change that we find across these commons. There's three kinds of ways in which they can be lost. One is conversion. As we said, lakes get converted to stadiums, bus stops, malls, housing complexes for the poor. So this could be public capture of these resources as a public goods, as a reframing of public goods at least. There could be private capture. In many cases, private real estate players have come in and taken over lakes and wetlands. The second way in which they can be changed is by degradation. You just have large numbers of people using them and they eventually, or volumes of sewage being let into these lakes because of the huge amount of construction around these areas. And then they become dumping sites, public toilets, areas for waste, solid waste and liquid waste dumps. So that's, they're there, but they really can't be used and they provide a disservice. And the third is when they're actually ironically protected and restored and they become gated commons, so to speak. So they serve certain recreational uses of a particular section of society, but they compete and they outcompete and crowd out the livelihood and subsistence uses of the poor. So this is an example of a particular lake that was restored and which is now patrolled by the home guards. And I don't know if you can read that, but it says no plucking of flowers, no fishing, no swimming, you know, no using the lake for anything else except you can take a jog or a walk around the lake. There's timings for entry. Many of the, for instance, the parks managed by resident welfare associations across Bangalore also have boards saying that rights of entry are restricted and the association can decide who enters and who doesn't and what uses are allowed and what uses are not, which is a dangerous slippery slope to go down. There's also landscaping for exclusion. When some of the things which are done with a lot of well-meaning effort, but these are, for instance, you may have landscaped outdoor gymnasium areas, play areas, and then pretty often, given the kind of socioeconomic diversity in our cities, you will find a slum just outside. And you see that the children in the slum never get to play in the landscaped, supposedly open-air free equipment in that open-air gym within the lake, just on the other side of the boundary. So there's exclusion by intent, but a lot of this is exclusion without intent. And it's just that I think we haven't figured out ways of doing this more collaboratively and making these more open spaces. It's not like the community groups that worked very hard to restore these lakes came with the idea of excluding others and wanted this to be only their lakes. In many cases, that's not the intent, and there are attempts at involving other groups, but they haven't progressed very far. So I'll give you one story at the end, because I know this is a landscape architecture conference and you're probably looking for practical examples. So this is one story of an actual practical restoration of a lake called Kaikondrali Lake on Sarjapur Road, a lake near my house. And there's a very vibrant group of people who have been working on this, many of whom are friends of mine. So this was the lake in 2006 and 7. I also live in this area, and when we started looking at this lake, it was choked with sewage, blocked with waste, a lot of waste dumps around it. We, as a group of residents, saw that there was some government work supposed to happen to restore the lake and started looking at a walk. So this is just, you know, some of the things we saw. We saw an abandoned borewell, people trying to suck water out of the lake bed, and even that got dry. There's sewage inflow, encroachment of stormwater drains because there's an apartment that has built on this, burial graves, we saw a carcass of a pig, you know, all kinds of uses. We saw a blue tarpaulin sheet with playing cards and alcohol bottles. So there were people who were using it also to play in the evening. It had gained somewhat of a reputation as an unsafe area for women to go in, especially in the evenings. And then the community started working on it. Now, when the community group started working on this, there was a detailed project report and a plan sanctioned by the BBMP. So this is a group of consultants who had a cookie cutter plan, as they have often for lakes across the city. This is what they had. A lake where the water, you can see the extent of the lake and the amount of water spread area had shrunk to really less than about half of the lake. And this is a water-starved part of the city which is entirely dependent on groundwater. So one thing that the local group, first thing that they said was, we want much more water and we want much less land in this plan. The second thing was, there was a huge amount of money that had gone into landscape gardening of this place. So very expensive. Again, these are places where various, you know, amounts of percentage can be skimmed off. And therefore, there was a lot of effort, emphasis here on heavy, intensive landscape gardening. So these were some of the things the community group worked on. A few other things, you can see the green patch. Let me see if I can get this to work. Well, the green patch at the east, the west side, right in the center, that was one of the most expensive gardening areas, landscape gardens, and that actually is the playground of a low-income government school, which is right next to the lake. Now, the playground has encroached on the lake, but it's a playground and it's of children who don't have access to another playground. So if we took that away to create this landscape garden, that would mean that they had no place to go. Instead, what, again, the community asked for is a re-envisioning of that area. So there are now steps, there is an atrium and an amphitheater a little below that. And this has become an open-air play area that children can access, and they continue to access, because that's where they have their lunch, they sit outside, they use. And the lake also has access to it. So the fence was put just at the border of the school building, but there's a gate that the children can still use. So these were some changes that the group started to work with. So this was a very collaborative project. Money came from the government. The restoration was done by a government-appointed contractor, but the community made sure that there was a representative from the community at the lake every day to make sure that things were followed, things were done correctly, and from then onwards. Now a trust maintains the lake and raises money from the community and from other groups that fund it. This is the lake after restoration. And about over 60 species of birds we saw return to the lake in about a year or two after restoration. We've seen some majestic species. So the pelican has come back, and we didn't, you know, if you look, talk to the village around it, for about 5-6 years before restoration, there were no pelicans. Now there are pelicans back. Painted storks come in large numbers, so that attracts a lot of people. Children come in. We use these to create, the lake is a great place to show conservation-based films, to take children on bird walks, nature walks, tell them stories around the lake. So it's become a very thriving community center. What is interesting is creating this space, the people who started working on this got to know other people. So this is a typical urban center, peri-urban. In any peri-urban part of the city, you don't know your neighbors. You don't know who lives across you in your apartment. But at this point, because of the number of people working on this, people from different apartments got together, became friends, and started working on many things. So there's a group of excellent, extremely committed women who work on solid waste management in Bangalore, one of the things that we're dealing with, and created something called a two-bin, one-bag program, which the High Court has now mandated to be expanded across the city. And there are a number of activities like this. People work with government schools, there are outreach programs working on the road and redevelopment of the road, all of which the lake acts as a social node for. And that has been a very interesting and very unanticipated for us outcome of this lake restoration project. In 2009, Eleanor Ostrom, who won the 2009 Nobel Prize for her work on the community, on the commons, came to the lake and planted a jackfruit tree. So that's also very nice. People come, she passed away a few months later, and people still come to the lake, look at the tree, wonder who, you know, she has there. We have a photograph of her up, find out about her a little more and go back. There's other initiatives that the lake has tried to do. So for instance, they work very closely with the school across the lake, and the school children are very much involved with lake management or education programs around the lake. There are the fishermen around the lake, which they used to work with very closely until last year. Now, unfortunately, the program of the process of selecting fishermen is not always in the community control. It's a bid, and it's done by government agencies. This year, it's gone to someone from outside the community who lives in a different part of the, you know, not from this area. And then it's very hard to coordinate. But the other things they do is there's always grass that grows within the lake. And unfortunately, one of the things the community did propose was to have a place for cattle to enter and for cattle to be washed in a separate water body. We couldn't get permission for this eventually. But people can come in and cut grass though and take it away. And that's fine. I mean, it's free fodder and they can take it away. So there are many things that the group is trying. But what I want to stress here is the effort is large, but the challenges are also large, because then actually getting, I mean, the barriers of social inclusion are so high, I think, in cities that we often try to include, but you find you still exclude much more than you can actually include. So it's an ongoing and an important learning process. Coming back from this, though, is then how do you redesign urban policies? If indeed the locus of poverty is shifting from the rural to the urban, I think urban ecosystems can play a very important role in addressing issues of poverty, of urban vulnerability, and vulnerability to economic shocks and vulnerability as well to ecological and environmental shocks and shocks induced by climate change, of drought, of floods, as well as shocks induced by just bad planning and people building over all sorts of places, you know, that they shouldn't be building in. So water is in urban commons that is important at two levels, for resilience of the city as well as resilience of the people and the most marginalized of the people in the city. And we need to figure out how to actually landscape to allow for these multiple uses. It's also a locus for biodiversity and environment protection, as well as for lives and livelihoods, not just for recreation and health or for water recharge, but for actual functioning livelihoods. So I'd end with arguing that we need to reconceptualize water through the lens of the commons, especially in urban landscapes, for their management. And in this context, what we find is the role of public-private partnerships, which are supposed to be funding 85% of these smart cities, is especially worrisome. Because if you fund, if private interests fund restoration of a place, most likely it gets to more gating. And that's the third example that I showed. We actually have restored ecosystems which are ecologically healthy, but people can't use, or the people who need to use them can't use them. With that, thank you.